Blackstone Audio presents War for the Planet of the Apes, Revelations, the official movie prequel by Greg Keyes. This book is read by Keith Szarabajka. Dedicated to Renee Hunt. Prologue. His first bullet hit a boy. It happened a split second after Jefferson abruptly stopped telling the story about the bar on Alki Beach and the nastiest drink he had ever had. His words were cut short by the sniper's bullet knocking the wind and the life out of him. That's when McCullough saw the figure in the gray raincoat, hood shadowing his face, the black hollow of a shotgun barrel looking him not quite in the eye. McCullough had been here before, many times. Sometimes he tried not to pull the trigger. Sometimes he imagined the first round missing, so that the boy in the raincoat turned and he got a good look at him, the wide brown eyes, the smooth cheeks that had no use for a razor. But whatever he wished, his bullet always arrived, and the boy slumped against the concrete wall, his hood falling back to reveal a face full of surprise, amazement even. He couldn't have been more than 13. The rain was between drizzle and a mist, as it had been for months. The woolly low clouds hid the highest of Seattle skyscrapers from sight, and overnight a core-chilling haze had crept down from the Cascades and flowed like dishwater through the streets. A hand-chalked sign advertising a daily special of soup and grilled cheese still stood in front of an empty cafe, once cheerful neon across the street, now dead and colorless. And just below a shop window advertising old-fashioned toys sat the boy, dying. At first he stared at the hole in his chest, but then he looked up and saw McCullough. McCullough felt his mouth open. Had he been going to say something to the boy? What? But then all hell broke loose, and McCullough heard himself instead yelling for his men to find cover as firebombs that smelled like turpentine spattered nearby. He turned the barrel of his rifle to the man off to his 2 o'clock who had just missed him twice, an older guy with another shotgun and a gray stubble of beard and glasses that rendered him essentially faceless. He squeezed off 2 rounds, and the man took 2 or 3 steps back before his legs gave out, and he stumbled down into the clutter of paper and hemlock needles that covered the street. Then another round from the unseen sniper clipped his ribs. It skipped off his body armor, but he still felt the shock go through him, like a breath he hadn't taken. He ducked back behind the brick wall. Forrest was there, young, wide-eyed, staring down at Jefferson, who looked almost as if he'd lain down to watch the low clouds slide slowly by. The hole in his head proved otherwise, and McCullough noticed that it was the work of a high-power rifle, not a shotgun. The boy hadn't killed Jefferson, or the man in the spectacles. "Forrest," he grunted. "He's gone. Snap out of it. I need you to spot the shooter." She looked up at him, saw his face, and her gaze hardened. "Yes, sir," she said. "He hit Jefferson the second we came around the corner," he said. "That means he must be somewhere between 11 and 3. When I cross the street, he'll shoot, and you take a look."
"Sir."
Instead of waiting for her protest, he let out his breath and sprinted past Jefferson's body, across the open ground to cover that seemed miles away, although it couldn't really be more than 20 feet. He didn't hear the bullet hit anything, but his ears caught the now familiar report of the high-caliber weapon. Someone else took a shot at him, too, but fortune stayed with him, and he rolled to cover behind a long-abandoned SUV. The sniper's rifle sang again. He looked over at Forrest, who was just returning to cover.
"Got him," she said. "3rd-story window.
Can you get a grenade in there?" She squinted her eyes a little, thinking, remembering the layout, and then nodded.
"Yes, sir."
"Okay, I'll give you some cover." He lifted himself up to peek through the passenger side window, and a bullet smacked into the vehicle. He counted 3, then stood and began firing at the 3rd floor of the apartment building. He saw a flicker of motion in one of the rooms, heard the sharp pneumatic exhalation of Forrest's grenade launcher. Orange flame belched from the window, and for a moment he saw the silhouette of a man with arms spread wide. Then only smoke. That wasn't the end of the fight, but after that it all grew hazy. There were a lot of them. If the so-called militia had been well-trained, McCullough and his people wouldn't have walked out of the ambush with only 2 casualties. In fact, they probably wouldn't have come out of it at all. But what he was fighting was not another army, just a bunch of people with guns.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.